All right. Thanks for joining us for this session of the Virtual Vice. We'll be going over a short presentation. We'll do a whole bunch of fly tying tonight. But this is Cheech talking. Curtis is in the back doing nerdy stuff with computers, so we'll move forward from there. Anyway, for the Hangouts users, we have you muted for now, just until we open it up for questions. So if you have any questions, it's best to keep you on mute just for now until we have any questions, just because everybody else can hear you kind of shuffling around and everything. Anyway, we're going to go over this presentation really quickly, and it's not going to be everything there is to know about streamers. And also know that, you know, these are just our opinions. Like we've said before, there really aren't any rules to fishing. So these are just some things that work for us. Instead of going over the patterns in the presentation, we want to kind of focus on mostly materials, but not just materials, but presentations, techniques, stuff like that. So we'll just get started. Hold on one second. All right. So, like I was saying, we're going to talk about materials, knots, and techniques. You can see this little splake has a nice piece of meat hanging out of its face. That fly was probably half as big as that fish. And we're going to talk a little bit about patterns at the very end. But first of all, there are several materials we want to highlight. Marabou is probably my most used material. You'll see in this Cheech Leech in this picture, I use three different pieces of marabou. Marabou is good because you're going to get maximum movement in the water. There are very few materials that flow like marabou does, so that's one of the strengths. Also, you can tie it in a bunch of different ways. As you see on the Cheech Leech, if you've watched the video, I palmer it like a soft tackle. On a woolly bugger, it's tied in for the tail. You can tie it in as an overwing. You can do so many different things with marabou. Really great material as far as diverse ways of applying it to the fly. And then the best part is it's not very expensive. I mean, it's cheap and available in pretty much any color you can imagine. You can buy it at craft stores. You can buy it in fly shops. You can get it from wild turkeys. Marabou is essentially a turkey feather. But anyway, in regards to marabou, we've had really good luck with Spirit River brand marabou in regards of just consistency of the product. You're going to find really good quality marabou with Spirit River. I mean, with the other brands, you can really find good stuff. You just might need to hunt for it a little bit more as far as like looking at every different package before you open it. Anyway, the downside to marabou is it might not be as durable as other materials. As you've seen, marabou, like, you can take it and just rip it apart. Imagine the teeth of a trout. You might have marabou that gets ripped up a little bit. So anyway, it might not be quite as durable as some of the other materials that we're going to talk about. All right, the next one, as you'll see on this little bass fly that we did, is rabbit, and specifically in zonker strips. It's a very commonly used material. You saw, I think the zonker is the first thing that really got it on the mainstream, and then when Scott Sanchez started tying the double bunny with it as well, has a pretty big fly with rabbit. But anyway, obviously it moves really well in the water. Even if you buy some zonker strips and the leather or the hide that the hair's coming off of, even if that seems a little bit stiff or misshapen, it really softens up in the water. So good move in the water overall. There's also a lot of different sizes and styles. You can get it in Magnum, which is, I think it's a quarter inch across. It's a little bit thicker strip. The fly that you're seeing on the screen, actually, you can find it somewhere, but it's called Texas Cut. It's about twice as big. I think it's a half inch wide. But then a cross-cut zonker is so that you can wrap it on the shank of the fly so that the fibers move back. Lots of different other things. This is a good time to also let you guys know that we're taking some major steps to overhaul our store on our site. And that's store.flyfishfood.com. And what we've decided to do is kind of go technique by technique, and we've decided to go with streamers first. So we're going to have what we're going to call the streamer depot with basically everything you need to tie streamers with. Anyway, so that's exciting. We're pretty stoked about that. Anyway, so back to the sizes and styles. You can see the barred rabbit strips where you can, I think Hairline's even doing olive barred and black barred and brown barred. Anyway, really cool stuff. Spirit River's dose jailed rabbit is pretty cool as well. The downfall of rabbit is it can weigh down your fly, a larger fly. So the thing about it is that all that leather or the hide that's sitting on the rabbit is going to absorb a whole bunch of water. So when it gets wet, the fly is going to be a lot more heavy than it was when you started. So something to consider. A lot of times when I do muskier pike flies or really big trout stuff, I kind of avoid rabbit so I don't have to end up throwing a 10 weight just to throw the fly. And, you know, as you know, it's a lot more durable than marabou. So a little bit heavier once it's wet, but it's more durable because it is on a strip of leather. Okay. The next one that we're going to go over is bucktail. Now you see in this fly, this is kind of a pike fly, a prototype that I did. And it's got a body of bucktail with like some Senyo laser dub over the head. But anyway, bucktail is a really good material for adding length and bulk. I think maybe this summer we'll be getting into some more of the big fish flies, you know, the predator flies. Similar to this one right here. We used bucktail in our video for the bearded lady. If you haven't seen that one, go check it out. You'll probably laugh a little bit, but it's definitely a fish slayer. That's a really good bug. But anyway, good length on bucktail. It's also available in a lot of colors. Most recently, Spirit River's come out with a series of UV2 colors in their bucktail, and it's really awesome stuff. And then some of the some of the musky specific guys, like I know Brad Bowen has some of the best bucktail in the country. It's really long, kind of fine, and just adds a lot of bulk. So bucktail, just like any natural material, before you buy it, if you can, go handle it. Pull it out of the package, check it out. But anyway, good stuff. The other thing about bucktail that you don't realize is that, you know, when you're tying it in, it seems stiff. But as soon as it hits the water, man, it moves really, really well. It kind of takes on different properties once it gets wet. And so I think you'll see that once you start tying with bucktail. For those of you who fish with clouser or minnow, you know, it's one of the best minnow patterns that there is, and it's tied out of primarily just bucktail and flashaboo or crystal flash, and moves really, really well in the water. And the other thing about it is it's fairly durable, maybe more durable than marabou, but not quite as durable as rabbit. And as I talked about before, there are different grades. Look at it before you buy it. I mean, obviously, not all deer are the same size when they get shot. So, I mean, like I said, some of the musky guys in the Midwest have some of the best bucktail that there is. every once in a while, if you go to your local shop, you'll be able to luck out with some really full, really long bucktails. All right, here we see the mongrel meat and the bug-eyed bootle. Things that these flies have in common is they're tied with either Arctic fox or temple dog. So these are just longer natural fibers. Other materials that would fall into this as well are like red fox, coyote. Any of those types of furs would work really well. In fact, one of the flies that I'm going to tie tonight is called a foxy clouser, and you're going to see just how simple it is and how effective it can be. I mean, it's a really good bug, and it's just tied with red fox. So on these types of materials, the body fur and the tail fur can be used, and the tail hair typically is a little bit longer, a little bit more dense. The body hair typically is a little bit shorter, maybe a little bit softer. So that's how it is on Arctic fox. And usually on Arctic fox, it will tell you whether it's body, fur, or from the tail. And it moves really well. I mean, I started using this, 7 or 8 years ago, when I started substituting Arctic fox for my woolly bugger tails. And we have some bodies of water here in Utah that have just lots and lots of numbers of fish. And so you'd fish a fly, a woolly bugger type pattern, and your marabou tail would be the first thing to disappear. Curtis just likes to put a chartreuse bead on a hook, and he calls it the Maddie Special with nothing else, because one of his flies fell apart to that point. Anyway, I fixed it by putting Arctic fox in for the tail. Anyway, good movement in the water, similar to marabou. Thing about it is more expensive than other materials. A small patch of hair is going to cost you anywhere from $4 to $7. But really, a tiny bit of it really goes a long way. So keep that in mind when you're looking to buy the stuff. And the major strong point is the durability of it. It's a lot more durable than marabou. It's more durable than bucktail. It's probably right up there with rabbit as far as durability goes. All right, this fly here is the snot goblin. Now you can see on the zonker strips on this fly, this is the dose jailed rabbit zonker strip from Spirit River. Really cool stuff. But the body material is what we're going to talk about, and that's schlappen. Schlappen and hackle fibers are really, really good for streamers. Now, I'm not talking about like your whiting primo grade dry fly hackle, but you can buy the strung Chinese hackle. That actually does really well, but the schlappen is really what stands out. You can see how full it is on the body here. And so really, really moves a lot in the water and adds a lot to your streamers. So again, it's got great movement. One thing that I was really surprised about is, you know, as I was tying these, I usually like to counter rib my woolly buggers with like some monofilament or wire. But as I'd get going tying these flies with schlappen, it's really durable. The stems are super durable on these, a lot more than just normal hackle. So take that into account when you're tying it. In fact, on this snot goblin, the hackle or the schlappen is wrapped through semi-seal, and then I take a piece of Velcro or like a wire brush cleaner to brush it out, and the stem didn't even phase the stem. So super durable stuff. The other thing, it's pretty widely available. Some of your shops might think that they have schlappen when they really have strung hackle. They look really similar in the bags. But schlappen is the real webby, buggy stuff like you see in this fly. So comes in a similar package. Another way that you can use it is you can hang it off the back of your fly and just tie the whole feather in as like a tail. So that's real common with some of the musky guys, just to add a lot of length to your fly without having to, you know, use rabbit or something like that. I don't typically do that. I typically just use it for palmering the body, as shown here in the Snot Goblin. One more thing about the Schlappen that I'll show you when we get to a fly that uses it is that there's a surprising amount of material in these packs of Schlappen. You know, you're looking at a pack of feathers that, you know, it looks like there are not very many in there, and it's like $5 or $6. So, you know, you're thinking, I'll just buy the Strung Hackle for $3. Well, when you pull it out of the package, there's so much in there. Like, I tie a lot with Schlappen, and I'm, you know, I haven't had to go replenish any of my colors I bought. So anyway, keep that in mind when you're using it. Then finally, this is probably the most broad of all of the all the materials, but it's just the synthetics that are available. So you see on the top fly here, Curtis has put a fish mask on it. The body, essentially this whole fly is made out of synthetic materials. And then on the bottom fly, that's the Sculpito, and it's got everything synthetic but the rabbit tail. So it's got semi-seal dubbing, it's got silicone legs. So lots of really cool synthetics that are out there to use. And that, like I was saying, chenille dubbings, flash, synthetic hair, craft fur. One of the really cool ones that we were dealing with earlier this summer was synthetic yak. Synthetic yak is really cool. It's put out by Cascade Crest. And with any luck, we'll have that in our store. But if you're a musky pike guy, it's a must-have. Anyway, synthetic fibers all have their own properties in the water. So really pay attention to how they move in the water. When I tied the Cheech Leech, the back half of the fly was designed to be 100% synthetic. Because I knew it would react differently in the water than the marabou collar. And so it causes it to hinge a little bit more. So get familiar with how your materials move in the water with the synthetics. Typically, synthetics are fairly flashy. So it's a good way that you can add flash. You know, holographic flashaboo is one of the things I've used quite a bit. You know, crystal flash, Palmer chenille. I mean, Palmer chenille's constantly on my desk, so really good for adding flash. And then the other thing is synthetics can be fairly inexpensive. Curtis and I have a bad habit of visiting craft stores to try to find ways to use those materials, and a lot of times you'll be walking through and you'll find the exact same thing that they sell in the fly shop, but for about a quarter of the price as far as the synthetic stuff. So again, to find how they move in the water, you kind of have to just put it on a fly and hope for the best and experiment. And don't be afraid to you know, even if you spend a lot of time putting a fly together, you think it's going to be awesome, but then it sucks, then you just got to move on. So you got to experiment quite a bit before you settle in with your materials. So experiment a lot. We do it quite a bit. All right. Moving on to the techniques. So again, this is where a lot of guys will probably differ with the techniques. I'm just going to briefly touch on it. First things first, use a loop knot. Okay? For any of you guys who learned how to fish Rapalas, use the Rapala knot or the loop knot. It's going to cause your fly to have a lot more action than normal. If you just tied it on straight. Also, vary your retrieve. You'll see in a video that I'm going to show you in just a second that on small streams, instead of stripping my fly from the back forward, I usually strip. I usually like to let my fly drift downstream before I start stripping it. So, and that just changes based on the stream or based on the situation. But don't use the same retrieve all day long and then wonder why you might not be catching fish. You got to change it up. Also, take a variety of patterns. That means different pattern combinations and color combinations. You know, I like to throw the big and meaty stuff. I like to throw you know, the articulated stuff quite a bit, but that's not always the answer. Sometimes they want something much smaller. So when you're fishing, change colors and patterns until you're getting fish interested at least. You'll get to the point where you pretty much know where the fish are going to be. And if you're putting what I call your fly right down Santa Claus Lane and they're not getting any action, then you probably need to change your fly. So get real comfortable with that loop knot because you'll be tying it quite a bit. All right. So here's an example of me fishing a small stream. And you'll see that I'm fishing it upstream instead of downstream because it's kind of a shallow little stream, but it's just loaded with splake. And if I were to walk up at the head of the hole and fish downstream, unless I was laying on my belly, I'd spook all the fish in there. So we'll check this out. Of course, I'm fishing the Cheech Leech. Okay. Don't mind the ugly casting. Just kind of rolling and flipping a big old Cheech Leech out there. Oh, I missed a fish right there, so I'm going to throw it up a little bit further. I missed a decent fish right there. There, so finally he committed, he ate it. Not a huge fish, but still, I mean, that fish just crushed the Cheech Leech. In fact, you should fish big, big flies on small waters, and you'd be surprised at what comes out from the rocks. Wonder who the cameraman is in this. Man, shaking all around. Isn't that a cool fish? Anyway, that was a very memorable day. Anyway, so that's just kind of an idea of how it's, you know, you can fish a streamer maybe a little bit more unconventional. Few patterns that we're going to go over. Not necessarily specific flies, but I like to have a variety of flies in my box. Flash versus no flash. My flashy big fly is the Cheech Leech. My minimal flash fly is the mongrel meat. You know, a lot of times I'll eat one or the other depending on the amount of flash. So, you know, have some real flashy stuff and then some that's more just plain. Large versus small. I always try to start out with the biggest fly that I can get away with. As you see, this big Cheech Leech creation, you've yet to see that. We actually just filmed the video on that. It's called the Double Wide Cheech Leech. And, you know, that thing is awesome, but that's not always the ticket. I always have some smaller sculpitos in my box. Or this first bug we're going to tie called the Kemp Bug. It's an awesome, awesome streamer. And then, you know, a lot of guys will have all the different shades of olive, you know, black, purple, red, pink. I always just like to have a good selection of something that's pretty dark and then something that's pretty light. Usually that means that I'm throwing something that's olive and then something that's like a tan or ginger color. I throw those colors a lot. And then something to think about is eyes versus no eyes. You know, that can make a difference. I've started putting eyes on my Cheech Leeches. But then, like on some of the cone head patterns, you're not going to have eyes. So, you know, sometimes that makes a difference, especially if you've got a really predatory fish. Your bigger fish, I think, it's my opinion that eyes do make a difference. Then Curtis is going to show you a tube fly that he's been tying, and just it's been an awesome pattern. I've seen him catch some really decent fish on this tube fly, but tube flies are something that you should consider as well. And just like I said, you know, have the mega articulated stuff like this huge double wide Cheech Leech all the way down to a single hook. So what that means, you just got to get more fly boxes and get to work. So there's a lot of flies you got to have. Anyway, that's it. I'm going to switch over to the vise now, and we're going to get started with some tying. We good? All right. Give us 1 second while we get it switched over. Okay. So, first things first, you can see we've got a little bit different vise here tonight. This is the Dynaking Barracuda. They've been nice enough to let us play with it for the last little while. Very solid vise. And I've got a 3X long size 8 hook. This is an Allen S403. TMCO 5263 would be your equivalent. And then I've got a chartreuse bead on this, but you can also use brass or gold. Most of the time when I fish this, it's got a copper bead. But anyway, I'm going to start off by adding some lead to the hook shank. And this bug is called the Kemp bug. And I started fishing it several years back. When I was fishing one of my home waters that has a whole bunch of brook trout in it. But anyway, I've caught multiple species of fish on this and lots of different size ranges too. So I've just got some black 6-aught Montana fly thread. The thread doesn't necessarily matter on this one. You're not going to see it very much. Just dress the hook to the back. Now, peacock sword is different from peacock hurl. You can see it's really sparse on one side, really full and curved on the other side. The tail on this fly is peacock sword. It was used a lot in the olden days, and still a very cool material. But anyway, I'm going to take 4 or 5 of those sword fibers, and I'm just going to lay those on the back. Now, this isn't the original Kemp bug. I have totally changed this up to make it more of a synthetic pattern, easier to tie. So I've got this clump of peacock sword, and I'm just going to tie that in, just kind of a short tag for a tail, and then wrap it up to the lead and cut it off. All right, that's where the natural or the original materials end. Now you've seen us use the Arizona synthetic dubbing quite a bit. This fly is using the mega synthetic dubbing. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to make a dubbing loop of the peacock color of mega synthetic dubbing, and I'm gonna fill that up pretty generously here, pretty full loop, because it's gonna need to go pretty much for the whole length of the fly. We've got our turbo dubbing twisters here. With any luck, we'll have those in the store soon, too. And then I'm just going to wrap this forward. So you can see you can make some really cool mini leeches with this stuff, too. And then I'm going to leave a little bit of room right behind the eye. so that I can wrap a soft tackle. Before I wrap that, I'm going to take just some trusty Velcro and just brush it out a little bit. Okay, got some more of these Coq de Leon hen saddle feathers. Really cool stuff. We used it in the last hare's ear video that we did. But anyway, I'm just going to take the tip of it. I'm going to tie it in tip first. Just like this. Trim off that little notch. And then I'm just going to take that and wrap it. Feathers are going to go everywhere here at first until I start preening them back. Once we get up to the bead, they're all just going to sit down. Okay, so you can see you could fish that right now and do well with it. One of the cool characteristics about the Kemp bug though is it had kind of like a spruce style wing but with grizzly hackle, so it had an overwing of hackle. And it was always difficult to find hackle that was of good quality, you know, good enough hackle. And so I started coming up with ways to kind of, you know, use synthetics or make it easier to make it more uniform. So what I've got is just like some Antron yarn or Polypro yarn that's white, and I'm just going to take that and tie it in right here behind the head, give it some wraps, and then just pull it back. Just like that. And we're going to essentially turn this into grizzly hackle. Got my trusty Sharpie here. And I'll try to turn this toward the camera and show you. But I'm going to make some black bars through it. Now I do this before I trim it. All right, so there we go. We kind of have a speckled type overwing. And then instead of just cutting it straight like this, I'm going to come in over the top and cut it kind of parallel to the hook shank. Kind of like that. And then just to finish up the head, I'll just tag on a little bit more dubbing. You don't have to do that. It just makes it look a little bit more clean. And then just a short whip finish. And as you whip finish this, if you did it right, you should be able to pull it and your thread wraps will actually sink down behind the bead. But anyway, that's the synthetic version of the Kemp bug. Man, it's been a really good bug for me for a lot of years. It's pretty simple, but that's a good example of a simple single hook streamer. All right. Enough of me rambling.
All right, my turn. Okay, we're going to start off. This is quite a bit different than probably a lot of the streamer flies you've seen in the past. And it's going to be it's a tube fly. And so what we do here with our vise is we tie in this adapter. And what that'll do, it'll allow me to tie the tube in. And got to get my stuff over here. And so what I start with is a tube. This is a Canadian tube fly tube, which is just this tubular piece of plastic. And before I do anything, I'm going to apply the hardware. So this is going to add a little bit of weight. And then I'm going to add a bead. And then the fly, one of the things that I think is a key part of this fly is the fact that it has this little inverted monster cone. And the way you work tube flies in general anyway is you need to burn away that nub. I'll show you here. So what that's done now, whoops, if I did it right. More than one way to skin a cat. And I'll just apply these. That burning just makes it so that they won't come off the end. So I'm dropping everything here. So this is basically the base of what we've got going on. And then one thing I like to do before I start is I'm just going to take some super glue, and this will help cement this in. What you don't want with tube flies, especially, because this is a, you know, it's a plasticky material, and your materials will slide around on it like there's no tomorrow. So it's always a good idea to apply a little bit more force in there so that it's not going to come undone. And the other thing is that because it's metal on plastic, that has a tendency to spin on you. So, and if you're not familiar with tube flies, one of the advantages is we can tie a really big sized fly on a relatively small hook. So we're going to use a hook which is a size 2 owner mosquito hook, and but I could really tie, you know, a size 6-aught size fly with this deal. So it really comes in handy. The other thing is it gives you a little bit more leverage. If you're tying a fly that's on a hook that's that long, the fish actually has more lever arm on you. So what this does is it reduces that, and it gives them a little less power as you're fighting them. It can also supposedly decrease the amount of time it takes to land a fish. So what I've got here is I've just tightened this in to the tube adapter on my vise, and this fly in essence is very simple. And so this is what I'm kind of the idea that I'm going for here. It's going to be slightly different, but I've got what will be the length of the body here, and I'm just going to tie these pieces in right in the plastic to brass junction area. And so just as with any fly, I'm going to apply my thread. And I'm just going to start tying in materials. And this, one of the things about this fly, and the reason I've used this a lot, is that it kind of was an accident thing. I was looking for a fly that would be weedless, and you can also use weedless hooks on these, which is kind of nice. They use wacky weedless hooks, bass hooks. What I found, though, is when I was pulling this through weeds, even though the hook was weedless, it actually, when it came against structure and different things, the little shield here, the monster cone, would deflect it against weeds and brush. So I could actually pull this through a lot of crap and have that not get hooked up. Plus, since it's super front heavy, you don't have a whole lot of hook on the backside, it has a really sharp undulation motion as it goes through the water. So it can dive real quick, and then as you yank it, it'll pull back up, and so it's got a really crazy motion. It works great for bass, but also for trout. You can fish it in rivers. In fact, this is more of kind of a crawdaddy brown trout color. It works really well. So we don't have a whole lot of materials on this because it's a pretty simple pattern. I'm going to start off with some silicone legs, and this is just one little chunk, and I'm going to cut it in half. So what I'm going for is to tie this in to be about the body length, so which happens to be half of this chunk. And I'm going to tie that in right on my brass piece here, just like that. And then secure that up into there. Make sure that it's going to stay. Okay, so that's that piece. Now the second material that I'm going to put in is some rabbit strip. This is the Spirit River UV2. This is dose gelled rabbit. It's a Sculpin color, so it's got some cool barring on the material. Same type of thing, I'm looking for about that same length and tie it in at that same point roughly, and then wrap forward over to secure it coming back down. Got a little extra there, I can clip that off. Okay, now for the flash, I'm going to use some Cascade Crest Hollow Blend. And this is a goldish silver. It's got some silver flecks in it. Same type of thing, about the same length. I'm just going to grab a hunk of that in that same length range. And I usually cut this stuff with my synthetic scissors because if you cut that with your good scissors a lot, it'll actually tend to dull them. So I'm going to tie that in right at that point. And I like to offset this a little so it's spread around the hook a little bit, everything at least. Coming back around. Whoop, a little too tight on the thread. We'll start off with some black then. Thread color really doesn't matter on this one. And again, just reinforcing it up the body. And then I'm going to chop this off. Okay, now once we've got that, we're going to start to form the body a little bit. And to do that, I'm going to use some of this Palmer chenille. It's from Wapsie. And this is a medium olive, but it's got some gold and silver in it. And what I do is I just tie that in right there. And I'm going to wrap that forward. And this just gives us some more bulk in the body. And as I wrap that around, I want to preen the fibers back so they get in my way a little bit. Like so. Now, it doesn't have to be super pretty. Okay, and then to finish this off, I'm going to do a dubbing loop. And we're going to use some Senyo laser yarn. And this is going to go in the dubbing loop. Now you want about 4 or 5 inches. And for the color, I'm going to use the Sculpin Olive color. And so go take a bathroom break while I build up my dubbing loop. I normally edit this out of the videos we do because building a dubbing loop is not all that exciting. Do-do-do. I did see a cool dubbing loop tool on YouTube the other day. There, that's good. Okay, we're going to spin that up. And then what I like to do is brush that out a little bit. It gives us some of the fibers, get some a little longer from the get-go. And then I'm just going to wrap the head, and again, it's not going to look pretty, just like anything that you do with these dubbing loops necessarily first right off the bat. Then the reason I put as much on there as I did is that way I can jam that into the area right behind the cone. If you've ever fished or tied with cones, you'll know that that's one of the challenges. And then tie that in right behind. And then I throw in some more thread wraps before I whip finish here. I'm actually going to do two whip finishes. Whenever it's behind that cone, I don't know what the crap's going on, so better safe than sorry. And as long as it's sliding back down in there, of course it gets hung up on my mandrel a bit. Okay, we're good on that. And one last step here is just to brush that out. And so this is where the senyo comes in handy, because this literally just will brush back over the body, and it will help form that nice, full-looking body, again, without adding extra weight or spinning anything, or, you know, and it just has incredible movement in the water. So there's our deflectinator. Again, the idea would be, as you, the way you fish this is that you have some junction tubing, which is a piece of, I use yellow, but yeah, you'll actually put that onto the tube like that. And then when you go to fish this, you put your tippet down into there, and then so the tippet comes out, you tie your hook on, and then as you pull that in, you snug your hook back up into this, and now you've got your hook in there. And the nice thing is, you know, this is just a regular hook, but I could use a wacky weedless hook if needed. And the other nice thing, although I'm not too worried about trout just tearing this apart because it's pretty sturdy, when you hook a fish, sometimes this comes apart, and then you just get him in the corner of the mouth with the hook, and the fly is free-flowing on the line and doesn't end up tangled in his teeth as much. So anyway, that's a tube fly. It's a great method for streamers in general, but this deflectinator, is a great pattern for streamers, bass, trout, doesn't matter. It's a really good one. And that's all I have to say about that.
It's always comforting when Curtis talks about nice full bodies on his flies. It's gross. Okay. Curtis is going to make me be the tying mule again. That's kind of where I fit in this company. Anyway, so when we were asking you all about what you wanted to see as far as flies, I mean, you guys have seen all of our good stuff on our video tutorials, but we were thinking, you know, we could do something that we haven't done, some patterns we haven't done before. And so I've been fishing a pattern quite a bit lately, and it's a very common fly. There's really not a lot special about it. It's called a foxy clouser. It's just a clouser minnow tied out of red fox fur. And the reason I'm deciding to do this tonight is because it's one of those flies that you can crank out a whole bunch of them in a hurry and have a really effective fly in your box. What did you do? My poor Dynaking. All right. So this hook is it's actually an egg hook. It's the Allen E601. The TMCO equivalent in this is the 105, I believe. And anyway, it's just a really sturdy hook. As you can see in the shape of it, it's just a perfect hook to tie a Clouser style flies on it. I'm just going to take some brown 6-aught Montana fly thread to start off. And I'm only going to wrap the thread not even halfway down the hook shank on this fly. The next step is just to add some barbell eyes. And I've got these brass barbell eyes with the eye in them. This is another Allen Fly Fishing product. And, you know, you can get real fancy with your clousers. You can tie stuff in and pull it up over the eyes and everything, but we're not going to get too fancy. This is just kind of a good utility fly to have in your box. By the way, the hook size on this is a size 2, and these barbell eyes are 4.8 millimeters. So I'll get that nice and locked in. And I'm going to tag it with a tiny bit of hydro to lock it in place. You can use super glue as well. I just have hydro right here. Okay. Now, essentially, this fly is only going to have two clumps of materials. One on the, this is actually going to be the bottom, because this, anytime you tie barbell eyes onto a hook on the top of the shank, that hook is going to ride hook point up in the water. So this fly is going to ride in the water like this, and that's a huge advantage when you're tying these bait fish patterns or like the Sculpito, because it will really slither over the rocks really well. All right, so first thing that we're going to tie in is just some copper flashaboo. You can use crystal flash on this, but I've been really liking the look of this copper flashaboo, so that's what I do my boxy clousers out of. Use quite a bit. You know, I've got, you know, 10 or 12 fibers, and I'm going to tie them in just like this. Tie them back a little bit, and then take all these fibers that you tied in and double them over. All right, then I'm just going to come in here and just kind of cut them at an angle. And make a big mess, so Curtis has to clean it up. All right. Now, I was lucky that a friend gave me this nasty fox pelt that he had at his house for a long time. So I just cut off the tail. And actually, I'm going to be using this fur right here at the very top of the tail. Not the tip, just the very top of the tail. You can see this material right here that's dual colored. Some coyotes that you get, if you shoot them, if you like hunting coyotes, or if you know somebody who does, or if your fly shop carries coyote, you can find it that looks almost like this, you know, depending on the coloration of the coyote. But anyway, we're just going to take a small clump of these tail fibers. I'm going to leave the guard hairs in, and it kind of got a little squirrely on me, so I'm going to trim it again so it's nice and flat. So I'm just going to lay that down right behind the beads, or right behind the barbell eyes, and tie it in. Now, if you wanted to put like a hot spot on this fly, you could use a different color of thread, because this thread will show through. Now all you're going to do is you're going to turn it upside down. Is that still in view? Okay. And I'm going to advance my thread up in front of the barbell eyes. I'm going to take another clump of this foxtail and maybe a little bit smaller clump for the top portion. And trim it up the same way I did the other one. Now when I tie this in, I'm going to kind of make sure that my thread is right here behind the eyes, so that when I trap it, I'm going to trap it down so that I have plenty of room to work with to cover up the butt ends of this. I'm just going to wrap forward, and it should cover it up real nicely and make it look pretty clean. So there we go, and then I'm going to take the fibers and split them and just put the hook through them. Pretty much like that. Now there's some memory in these fibers, so they're kind of hanging down, but when this gets wet, they'll all kind of taper back like this. It's a really cool looking bug. But anyway, all I'm going to do now is just whip finish. So that's pretty much it. Like I was saying, you can crank out a whole bunch of these in a short time. The other thing that you can do with this is you can use Arctic Fox. Like a good color combo would be like white on the bottom and olive or chartreuse on the top. But anyway, I'm going to show you also one of the reasons why I think it fishes so well. But we talk a lot about UV qualities of materials and UV reflectance versus UV fluorescence. And the natural fox fibers have a lot of UV fluorescence. You'll see as I cure this, you see how that fox really lights up. So I think that contributes to why this pattern is so effective. But anyway, I've always got some of these in my box. It's a simple pattern to tie and a really great one to fish. All right. So there, two flies on a single hook. Hopefully that did it for you guys. Now we're going to move on to something a little bit more advanced, but still pretty dang simple. One of the best streamer patterns of all time is just the good old circus peanut. And I'm not even going to tie the full version of the circus peanut. I'm just going to show you a way, like if you don't want to spend a ton of time at the vise and you want to have some good options when it comes to articulated flies, this is kind of a circus peanut variation fly that will work really well for you. All right, let me find the stuff. All right, for hooks, I'm going to be using the Allen S402. Two of them. They're the size 2. But it's a streamer hook that Allen puts out. Anyway, just stick it in the vise. I'm using like some cream colored thread. This is going to be like a yellow and white and gold pattern, just that light coloration that I was talking about. And so you're just going to basically tie in the thread. And on this fly, I'm going to put two different shades of yellow marabou. And this is a technique that you can do not just with your not just with this streamer, but like with woolly buggers and any other type of fly you want to fish that has a marabou tail. This is a good way to stage the colors. But anyway, I've got a kind of a dirty yellow color. So I'm going to pull off a clump from the stem. I usually don't tie in the tips like this. Now some guys like to do that. But I'm just going to take a clump that's about the length of the hook, and I'm just going to lay that down and tie it in. And before I trim it, now I'm going to take a little bit brighter color of marabou, and like I was talking about, this is the Spirit River marabou. You can see that, you know, just right out of the package, it's just really good stuff. This is the ideal marabou to use for cheech leeches. But anyway, you see it's a little bit lighter color. Just take a clump of that and tie it in right on top of this. All right. Now, instead of trimming all this off, I'm going to kind of come in at an angle like that and trim off the hard stuff off the butt ends, and I'm just going to pull all that forward and wrap it forward, and that will kind of make the body a little bit more uniform. All right. Now, I'm going to show you how much schlappen you get in one package. This is from one package of white UV2 Spirit River schlappen. And so, and this is after me using it quite a bit. Then the other thing is that the fibers, the feathers really don't look very impressive when you pull them out. But once you get wrapping them, I mean, they're really long fibers. All right. So I'm going to take a piece of white schlappen. You can use yellow as well, or even like a tan color would go well. And then I've got some, let's see, what's this called? Like golden yellow, sparkly chenille of some sort. You can basically use whatever you want. So I'm just going to tie in a little bit of chenille here. Bring that all forward. And then wrap the chenille forward. Like Curtis is saying, this is the boring stuff that you usually don't have to see in our videos. Actually, I forgot, you got to leave a little bit of room in the front because we're going to tie in a marabou overwing. Okay. So now with the schlappen, I'm just going to wrap it forward. And it can kind of get messy, and that's fine because, you know, it all takes shape when it's in the water. But you can see how much that sticks out more than normal hackle. So what is it that I just barely tied? It's essentially just a woolly bugger, just with a little bit different materials. All right, so I'm going to pull those back, create a little bit of a base, and then I'm going to take this same, the lighter color of marabou, and I'll tie in an overwing of that. Just about that much, maybe a little bit more. I'm going to cut that flat before I tie it in so it ties in nice and clean. Let me try to do that again. Okay, so there you have the back half of the fly. All right, the front of the fly is essentially going to be the same type of deal. Now on this fly, you can either put barbell eyes on it or you can use a cone head. You can do a bunch of different things. And I'll throw on some barbell eyes on this one. Okay. Get my thread put on. I'll kind of go fast through these steps so it's not boring you to death. Oh, I can show you this though. I've been messing with a new kind of super glue. It's a very thin super glue. I've showed it on some of our videos, but it's from Hobby Lobby. But it's super, super thin. And let's see if I can capture this, but just put a tiny dab on and it will soak in and just saturate that whole section of thread wraps. So anyway, that'll lock those eyes in just really solid. Then I'm going to take some articulation wire and get about, 4 inches or so. I'm going to tie that in with a little bit extending out past the eyes. Now, like you've seen us do, when I tie the articulated section or tie the front part, this wire hanging on, I like to come down the bend a little bit more, just so that the back half of the fly hangs parallel or even with the front hook. So anyway, I'm going to throw on, you can put any color of beads on here, but to give it a little bit of a transition, I'm going to tie in a couple of red beads just to break up the light color a little bit. Those are the articulated beads that we have. Now, if you see what just happened, I took some of these rare earth magnets and I just stuck them to the side of the Dynakine. That way, I can just stick my back half of the fly and it sticks there. And you can see I can string up my second half of the fly. When I pull it forward, it's just going to move it right into place. So it'll move right with where I need it to go. That's kind of a thing. I was an accident. My daughter had come and put, she was using this magnet on her peak vise, and she put it back on my vise right here. And it's actually been really good. So anyway, I'm going to tie that in. Come all the way up here to behind the eyes, and then I'm going to fold those over and wrap it back. All right, so now we're all wrapped in nice. And now for the front half, we're essentially going to do the same thing over again. Get a nice full piece of marabou. We'll tie that in right here. Maybe a little bit thicker than that is how I want it. And then I'll take the light color and just tie it in on top. Enough to give it a little accent. Okay. Cut it at an angle a little bit and tie it in. Another piece of big old fat schloppin'. And this is the UV2 white schloppin'. Been really good stuff for us. And I'm tying it in tip first. And the reason why I start a little bit further down from the tip, because you see these fibers are all pretty small. I want them to be pretty big fibers. Okay. Okay. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to wrap this forward. But I'm not going to cut that off yet. Now I'm going to wrap forward with the schloppen. and tie it off. You can see it's just nice and really big and buggy. And then I'm going to just kind of figure eight that right here through the eyes. I think my headset's about to run out, so we're going to make a quick change here real quick. Nobody better comment that I look like a cyborg with this Bluetooth piece in. Okay. So we'll try this this headset. So to tie in the headpiece, I go pretty thick with it. I'm going to tie in, you know, some more of the darker color underneath. And then I'll go with the lighter color on top. That's pretty sparse, so we'll add some more to it. All right. We'll keep building that up a little bit. It's really easy to get it in right behind the eye at this point, so just try to keep your thread or your materials away from the eye as much as possible. It looks like this piece of marabou was butted up against some black marabou or something that died through, so oh well. Okay, now I'm just going to give it a little bit of a highlight over the top. So you can see, as I was talking about the marabou in the presentation, how there are so many different ways to apply it. And so, you know, this is a really cool way. Even if you tie woolly buggers with this overwing like this, it can turn into a really cool fly. Anyway, to finish up the fly, I'm just going to kind of create a head here. Kind of a big head, but whenever it gets like that, I just coat it with clear cured goo. But anyway, that's essentially the fly. That's a circus peanut variation. To make it a little bit more fishy, like the circus peanut, you can add a whole bunch of silly legs to it. Really makes it cool. But I mean, the cool thing about this type of fly is you really don't need a lot of crazy exotic materials to do it. It's essentially just chenille, marabou, and schloppen or hackle, and then you've got it. So anyway, that's kind of the circus peanut variation. You can see it's pretty much the same size as a Cheech Leech. It's going to move great in the water because it's all natural fibers, but this is one of the classics that are out there. All right, we'll do one more. Let's see. I was thinking about it, and was a toss-up between like the Cheech Leech or the Mongrel Meat. And I was thinking I'd do the Cheech Leech for you again, because I've got a kind of a secret variation of the Cheech Leech that I don't know, it's not that I'm keeping it secret, I just haven't shown it to anybody else very much, but it's just a shorter version of the Cheech Leech. It's a pretty small, little compact fly for an articulated fly. It has really good action. In fact, one of the fish in that presentation, there's a nice rainbow trout with the compact Cheech Leech hanging out of it. And for this one, I actually use a Daiichi 2461. This is a size 4 hook, but relatively speaking, it's not a very long shanked hook. So anyway, I'm going to stick it in there. The reason I like this is, you know, number one, I think it looks really cool. You know, it's black. But secondly, it is one of the sharpest hooks that I've ever tied a fly on. I mean, this thing is brutal. You really have to be careful when you're tying with it. So I'll tie it in. It's a variation that I've been messing with out of the Canadian olive coloration. I think I've got the right marabou for it. Yeah, I do. So we'll do it out of the Canadian olive color of semi-seal. This is not mega semi-seal. This is normal, regular old semi-seal. Canadian olive is a very popular color. And if you see, you know, if your shop has the Metz brand of semi-seal, or, you know, a lot of other companies will market it, the guy that makes this does make it for all those companies, so it's essentially the same stuff. So anyway, I've got the Canadian olive. You can see all the different colors in it. And I'm going to just kind of bunch it up and create the tail out of the dubbing. Right. Let me make sure that I got the right flash. Where did it go? There we go. So this is midge flash in root beer color. It's just like crystal flash. It's just a lot more fine. So I'm going to grab three or four of those fibers, and I'm going to put them on each side of the tail. So one on one side, fold it over and do it on the other side. I'm going to trim those just so they're a little bit longer than the tail. Okay, now I've got some brown Palmer chenille, and I'm just going to tie that in, just like the other Cheech Leech. The brown is, excuse me, sucked in some marabou there, but the brown is a darker color than the root beer, so that's a color that we'll use on this little guy. So we'll tie that in right by the stem. And then when I tie that in, I always make sure that the fibers are facing back. That way, when I start wrapping the fly, they're going to wrap around the hook shank just like I want them to. Got to grab a drink real quick. What, are people clowning us on Instagram, Curtis? No? All right. Okay. All right, I'm going to make a dubbing loop. Curtis has made a mess out of this desk. So I'll just build up the loop. It's got to cover the whole shank of the hook, so it's got to be moderately big. And then I'm just going to wrap it forward. Remember, the Cheech Leech is not meant to be a very pretty fly until it's all done. So, got stuff going everywhere. I've got marabou sticking to me. All right. Now we're just going to take this Palmer chenille. We're going to wrap this up through. And I like to keep it fairly tight when I wrap it through, so that when you brush it all out, it's not going to pull out of there. All right, pull those fibers back, and then I'm going to add some more flash to it. So three or four more strands of the midge flash. tie it in like this, and then pull those back over to double up your amount of midge flash. Create a little head, doesn't necessarily matter. And then just trim it off. All right. Oh, crap. I knew it was going to do that. That's what we get for hurrying. All right. I'm going to try to salvage this real fast. Don't look. This is where Curtis edits it all out, but it will look just like it never happened. Yeah, that's never happened to me before. We'll reattach the midge flash. I like that head better anyway. What was I saying about wrapping the Palmer chenille tight so it didn't come out? Okay. Should be good now. Perfect. And again, you can fish this fly just like this. I actually fish this fly a little bit in lakes, and I call it the back half. And it's the back half of the Cheech Leech. Now, just to make sure that doesn't go anywhere, I'm going to actually tag it with super glue. Just a tiny bit. Okay. So you can see that's considerably smaller than the back half of the big Cheech Leech. But the majority of the reason why it's a smaller profile is because I space it with only one bead. So I'm going to attach my thread again. Tie in a decent size barbell eye. I mean, you can change the size if you want it to sink a little bit less. Tag it with the super glue. Some more of our wire. Now, we ran out of these articulation beads for a little while, and normally I'd be using the orange ones, but I'm just going to use like a dark colored black bead to connect these two. Okay, so just one bead instead of two. And that's even too small for this little magnum to move it up. All right. Okay, you've seen this all before. That's pretty much the standard way I connect all my articulated flies. Same piece of Palmer chenille, And we'll just build up our body just like we did for the back half. All right, that should just about do it. W loop slipped out, that's all right. There's something about tying streamers that's just really fun because you don't have to be just neat and perfect like you do when you're tying, you know, midges and nymphs and things like that. I mean, you can just throw it on the hook and hopefully it works. So it can be messy, and usually I got a little bit of rage against the machine going in the background when I'm tying streamers. Okay. So we'll brush that out. Can I borrow that color of silly legs you were using on yours, Curtis? I think those will go well with this. All right. Now this is the major difference between the big Cheech Leech and this size of the Cheech Leech. And that's how you apply the marabou. If I were just to take a piece of marabou and start palmering it through, that marabou would pretty much cover up the whole fly. And so I'm just going to take a couple pieces of marabou and clump it in section by section to kind of give it that effect of the mixed marabou. So essentially I'm going to take a piece of this like dark tan or ginger and just tie that in right here, kind of over on the far side of the hook like that. Then in the middle I'm going to take some light olive. I know that those are, it's kind of a weird color combo, and I'll throw that in there right next to it. That piece wasn't any good. Like I was saying, you gotta kind of pick through your marabou to find ideal pieces to tie these with. Curtis is kicking back and eating Cheetos or something over there. All right. So the next clump is olive. I'm going to tie it right in the middle, right on top of the hook shank. And just follow that pattern all the way around. Just kind of giving it a striped effect. And I'm just kind of measuring these clumps against each other to make sure that we're getting right about where they need to be as far as length. And yes, this one does take a little bit more time to tie because of how we got to put the marabou in. This is where I always poke myself with this stupid hook. So far we've got, just to add one more clump of olive. Right here. All right, so you can see how that kind of flows, and it still leaves the back half of the hook pretty much alone. It will still give it a lot of movement. So I saw these little silly legs that Curtis was using, this color. We'll have to look. Do you know what color that's called? No? We'll look it up. Anyway, I think that would look pretty cool on that fly. So I'm going to take just two of them and tie two in on each side. That's really gross, Curtis. I had to lick my fingers. Here, you're going to have these back now. Now that I have my spit all over them. Okay. And I'm actually going to trim those up just a tiny bit. They should just extend right to where the marabou ends. The original size Cheech Leech has three legs per side. All right, now all I have to do is create a head, just like I've done with the other, like the Sculpito and the other Cheech Leech. But I'm going to create a dubbing loop up here closer to the eye where it's thinner, and then I'm going to wrap the dubbing loop back so that it comes off the hook right about here. All right. Simmy seal's getting squirrely on me. There we go. And you got to be careful because you don't necessarily have as much room to work with on this one as opposed to one of the bigger flies that you use this style of head. So, and again, when I'm wrapping it through these barbell eyes, I tease it out a little tiny bit. So, two wraps right behind the barbell eyes, and then I go. Let me do that again so I can show you. So I'm going to go across and around this far eye, and I'm going to cross over the top in front of the eye and then around that back eye. So I've essentially like figure-eighted across the top of it, and then I'm going to give it two to three wraps right in the front and then tie that off. And one key when you're cutting off these dubbing loops, if you just barely open your scissors a tiny bit and kind of stick it in there and then move the thread over into your scissors, it'll cut it off but still leave all that dubbing from the loop right there so it doesn't create kind of an unnatural cutoff point. So I'll preen those back a little bit, build up a tiny bit of a head, and then just whip it. So there you have it. That's one of my best patterns right there, just a fish, a smaller version of the Cheech Leech. Not always do they want the full-size version. Let's see if I can get this looking good for the camera here. Too much spit on it. But anyway, that's pretty much it. The mini version of the Cheech Leech, and actually this color is a really good producer as well. This kind of burnt olive, dark tannish color, and this light olive is really good. So, anyway, let's see. Curtis, do we have people on Hangouts that want to ask? Okay, looks like everyone's on YouTube tonight. Perfect. Well, give us some comments if you have any suggestions, or if you know, maybe even a suggestion for a topic for next Virtual Vice. I think we'll be able to do these about once a month, and maybe more if we can get around to it. But give us your comments, ask us your questions in the YouTube comments or on Instagram, Facebook. You all know we're pretty responsive, so we appreciate y'all for sticking around with us, and we'll see you next time. Want to say anything, Curtis? No? Of course not. See you guys.